Well, howdy and hi, friends and neighbors. We have an absolutely incredible show, amazing and provocative as always. Some from all groups may find it blasphemous, saying, heretical, saying, you can't say this, you can't say this. What we're doing is we are simply kindly, gently looking at and to see what we can see. Let's see what we can see. If we really try to look, to accept the guidance of the Holy Spirit, what do we see? That is the question. Now, last Sunday, I decided I have to get out and exercise. I played around a golf. The night after that, I had so much intense pain throughout my entire back area, from the neck down to the bottom of the spine. I couldn't sleep at all. It was a horrible, horrible, one of the worst nights of my life, so much pain. And in this half sleep, I began to be able to see all sorts of things. I saw into the future. What I saw was this amazing transformation of the planet. And what it was is this credit scheme, a carbon credit scheme is what I saw, is that everybody, money was gone, replaced by a credit system. The credit system is based on carbon credits, as it were. And the way the world was being run is by bureaucracy. And everything, your whole life was being monitored. Everything you did was being monitored. And you earned credits through your behavior. You earned these carbon credits. And you use these carbon credits to survive, to buy stuff. Okay, you needed them to buy a home, to pay bills, to get a car, everything. You needed these credits. And if you didn't do what the bureaucracy wanted you to do, you didn't get the credits. So of course, if you didn't agree with this, the way life is, you wouldn't get any credits, and you won't be able to do anything. You won't be able to survive. Interesting, isn't it? So I saw all this frantic trading and speculation in these carbon credits, like a stock market, a world stock market on these carbon credits. I imagine there were, like, you know, black markets in it, and people were frantically dealing with each other only in terms of these credits. How can they get more carbon credits? It was just an amazing hustle going on in the world. Totally different than it is now. And I have no doubt that that's where we're headed very quickly. Also had great insight into that strong prophetic dream I had a while ago of World War III, the collapse. And I saw all these tumbling boulders as the forces that reject the fifth dimensional, the paradise of the fifth dimension, is the Holy Spirit's training program of how to drop definition of what we are. Now keep in mind that anything that can be defined, is any definition is a definition of death, actually. Any vulnerability is simply the play of mind in trying to train us into how to die, train spirit how to die. Any vulnerability, anything you go wrong, you hear these New Age teachers talk about, well, all this stuff has gone wrong, but we're fixing it now. We're healing it, all these problems, all these blocks, all these troubles, etc. I tell you this, all of that is simply the play of mind. It's like a movie. All sickness, all troubles, all irregularities, out of alignment, healing, fixing, all that is all a movie that the mind is presenting us. Very important to accept that when mind tells spirit, it can train spirit how to die. First, mind has to project a simulation of creation, a simulation. But in this simulation is designed so that everything can go wrong in it. See, in true creation, nothing can go wrong. It's impossible to have problems. And yet in the simulation, we have to have the mind is telling us, look, here's how you die. See, here's creation, and then here's how creation comes unglued, and you have all these troubles and problems. It's a simulation. It's a movie that mind is presenting. So all this talk, and there's so much of it about New Age, this and that, and we're coming into Age of Light, we're doing all these things, 3D, 4D, 5, integrating 5D, 6D, 7D, all the blah, 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 endless stuff, endless talk. That's all just the mind, the play of mind. It's not enlightenment, it's not salvation at all. The Holy Spirit's training program to go beyond definition, that is enlightenment. That is the path of enlightenment. And that's not talked about in this world. I can't find that talk about it at all. It's something that has to be directly revealed, because the story of mind doesn't include this at all. It leaves us out entirely. It leaves it out. It's amazing. It's like Daffrey John commenting on all the spiritual teachers in history and leaving Ananda Mai Ma out. You know, it's like, whoa, that's a very significant omission, isn't it? Because again, the play of mind will leave out that which is true salvation, to totally ignore it as if it doesn't exist at all. Totally ignore it, it's not there. So when you go searching in the world for these answers, you can't find them, and then you get discouraged and you say, wow, it must not be true, I can't find it. So it's because the mind says there is no such thing. There is no such thing. Remember, the mind is presenting the idea of how spirit can die to itself so it can become prime creator. And this is the story of the death of spirit, believing, accepting that the spirit has died, and that acceptance then enabling you to resurrect, to resurrect and become a new life, which is now the new creation, that you are now prime creator of a new creation. That is the story that mind is trying to tell, right? Is presenting to us. And in that story, there is no such thing as the death-free realms, where the Holy Spirit gives us this training to drop definitions. Okay, so it's something that to me was revealed inwardly. I actually, in spirit, traveled to the death-free realm, and experienced it directly. And then the Holy Spirit has gradually explained to me, you know, what's really going on here, what's actually going on. But I didn't read it in books. I didn't find it out in the world. Almost everything in the world is just the story of mind, the mind story. Almost everything. Not everything. Some stuff is like symbolized in ways that can get past the mind story. But to have it directly explained is very rare here. It doesn't fly well in the world. You know, people don't listen to it. They don't pay attention to it. They don't believe it. They say, whoa, you know, how can I integrate this with the mind story? Well, you cannot. The mind leaves this out. The mind says, ask you to do one thing, the mind tells you, just do one thing for me, and that is, don't pay any attention to the Holy Spirit, just accept the mind's explanation of what the Holy Spirit wants. You see, that's what most people have done, is they accepted mind's explanation for as if mind were speaking for the Holy Spirit. That's what most have done in the world. They don't listen directly to the Holy Spirit, because it seems very, very different, very, very different. Now, when I played golf on Sunday, and I had this terrible backache Sunday night, I said, you know what, I can't play golf ever again. This is just horrendous. And I had to finally accept that it was my swing that was doing it. I have this wonderful swing, but it's killing my back and destroying me. Now, something very interesting happened on that golf course. I was a single, as I always do. And there was a threesome supposed to join me. They never showed up. So the starter moved up a twosome to join me, to go out. So, okay. Now, in this twosome was a player that had the weirdest swing I've ever seen. And I looked at it, I said, my God, that's messed up. I said, wow, I've got this wonderful swing, and that one's terrible. But as the round went on, he kept hitting these balls beautifully. I said, well, it's just luck. It's luck. And then I started hitting some really good ones, but his ball was always like 20 yards past mine. I was like, wow, well, where's he getting that power? It's incredible. And then the whole round he was accurate. And I said, you know, maybe it's not luck. And then I told him, I said, hey, you know, I would copy your swing, except it's so complicated I can't figure it out. And he smiled and laughed and said, you know, like, yeah. And so then just this afternoon, about 20 minutes ago, I said, you know what? I wondered if his swing actually, it was not just a coincidence, because before I went to the golf course, I prayed to the Holy Spirit. I said, please make this day a very blessed day, and that helps me out, maximizes help for me. And then I said, nothing happened. No help came. And then just 15 minutes ago, I thought, I wonder if that swing that he was using, actually I could use it and it wouldn't hurt my back. So I went out and I tried to copy it a little bit, and I realized it doesn't hurt my back. And I actually realized that it has tremendous clubhead speed. And if I can actually hit it, it takes good coordination, I guess, to hit it that way. It would hit the ball very, very far without hurting my back. So I may be able to keep playing golf because of that. So You see, the Holy Spirit works in very amazing ways, actually. Ways that we don't even expect. And the man was very, very nice man. Wonderful man. Very clean cut. And together, his whole game was fabulous, but very unique game. But I kept being more and more impressed. The more I saw it, I said, wow, he's really got it dialed in somehow. But it was, you know, not classical, it was unique. Now, a lot of what I say seems very unique, and you don't hear it elsewhere. You really don't hear it elsewhere. And we're all straining to follow the classical teachings, you know, but the classical teachings may very well be the mind's presentation of what it wants you to believe is true. And if you listen directly to the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit is going to tell you a very different story. And you might say, hey, this isn't classical. I can't stand up to the world and say, hey, I'm a great Christian, you know, because I believe that Jesus died for my sins and his resurrection means I have eternal life, and all I have to do is believe that he died, in other words, spirit died, and then I'll be resurrected to eternal life. If I, you know, I can't stand up to the world and say that. I have to say what the Holy Spirit has shown me. And when people listen, they say, ah, you're no Christian at all, you're terrible. So, like that golfer, I said, you know, people look at him and say, on the first tee, I said, this guy's got severe problems. I mean, look at that swing. It's just like completely funky. I mean, he's no way he can be able to hit the ball. This is a nightmare. There's a train wreck. And it turns out not at all. In fact, he was the best golfer there by far. He was fabulous, just fabulous. Love the way that he played. It was just great. And so I said, you know, I can't do that. That's too weird. But now I'm thinking, hey, maybe I can. Maybe I can. Now, of course, others will look at, you know, when I give this teaching out, people say, ah, you're terrible. You're nothing. You're terrible. It's all weird. I don't understand this at all. But hopefully, I can show some results at some point. And some people can say, hey, don't argue with results. And there may be some that are suffering so bad, like I was with my back, I realized I cannot go any further with that swing. Literally, I can't play another round of golf if I keep that swing. And so I said, either I quit golf or I change my golf swing. And then suddenly I said, why don't I change it to that man's golf swing? And son of a gun, if it didn't generate tremendous club head speed and save my back entirely, I wonder if he didn't pick it up to save his back, you know? I wonder if that's possible. So all these so-called spiritual teachings in the world may be breaking us down real bad. And we may be feeling like, you know what, I just can't keep on believing in this stuff because it just doesn't fly. Because the fourth dimensionals are coming in and the whole situation, 2D, 3D, 4D, the mixture of all that is just going to cause an unbelievable ruckus here. And the world will be impulsed into all sorts of troubles. And my beliefs simply don't give me wings. You know, I feel being impulsed into attack and irritation and all this stuff. And I don't like that. I just can't go on believing this stuff the way I am. And then you listen to this and you say, here's a very different explanation. And you might even try it and say, hey, you know what, that generates a lot of lift. It generates enough lift to lift myself right out of this situation. Now you may say, well, it's too difficult. Well, I haven't played guitar for 10 years. I haven't even touched a guitar for maybe 10 years or more. And let's call it 10. And I wondered, can I even play guitar? I doubt it. I haven't even thought about playing guitar. And so I got this guitar and I struggled for a couple days, but suddenly, it suddenly starts coming back to me. And I ordered this a tuner right here. That just came yesterday. I tuned the guitar up. I ordered some picks, and I got the picks now. And suddenly it's all coming back to me, like riding a bicycle. I realize I can play as good as I ever played once I get it back into shape. So, as far as truth goes, we may think, you know, we've overlearned the lies of mind. so much that there's just no way in the world we're ever gonna get back to what we were. And I say that's not true. That's not true. You may recover awareness of what you are much better than you realize. The Holy Spirit's training program, you may quickly suddenly pick it up, you know, and say, wow, this isn't difficult at all. I remember this. Keep in mind, what better way to define our death, the death of spirit, than to create this massive, massive spatial area. And then these little tiny, tiny stars, and then even tinier, tinier, tinier little planets, and then these infinitesimally small little bodies, and then mind to tell us that we are these bodies. You see? And in the scope of it, we're looking out in the space, and we say, oh, I'm just this tiny little body looking out at this just infinitude of space. You know, I'm nothing. I'm absolutely nothing. It creates this feeling like total insignificance. And then mind tells us, you see, that feeling of total insignificance, that's very close to death. You've almost got it. And if you just feel this insignificance long enough, you will die to what you are. Spirit, you will die. So spirit keeps waiting and waiting and waiting and identifying with bodies on planets, in a solar system, in a galaxy, in this universe, waiting for its death, and its magical resurrection into a new, being a new spirit, a new life, and now being prime creator, self-created. So that's what's taking place. That is what's taking place. And of course, in this story, there's all sorts of structure and complexities and stuff going on to symbolize creation. This is just a simulation of creation. And all the structures there so that it can be broken down, so that there can be problems, so that we can experience, oh my God, what went wrong? Oh, I thought I was balanced and my polarity was fine, and oh, my polarity is now out of balance and I need to rebalance it, you know, and oh, something went, you always hear the story of mind saying, we almost had it, but something really mysterious came along. God threw a monkey wrench into it. And now we got all these problems, and so we're furiously scrambling to try to figure out this problem. But we know it's all part of our cosmic evolution. It's all good for us. You know, it's rebalancing the higher blah frequencies, and it goes on and on and on and on. That's the story of mind. That's the story of mind, and it's very difficult. Spirit has a very, very difficult time seeing through this because it wants to believe. It wants to believe there's a way to die. So of course it believes the story of mind. It believes it. So it believes, yeah, this is creation, this is life, and I'm in this movie, and all this stuff is part of my journey. It's part of my expression of what I am. It's what God wants me to do. And all these, spirit believes these lies that mind is telling. So it is extraordinarily difficult because it's all based on desire. As Buddha said, the root of all suffering, desire is the root of all suffering, which is very true. Because this desire to be prime creator results in spirit believing the story that mind is telling it and believing in it, suspending disbelief. But the Holy Spirit comes in and starts challenging this belief, gently challenging it and saying, hey, now wait a minute. Look at this. Is this true? And then this is true. Okay, well then how can this be true? I mean, is it really true? And you say, well, if something doesn't fit here. And the Holy Spirit says, okay. So gradually the Holy Spirit builds up the capacity of spirit to recognize that all of this is just a simulation, it's not real, and spirit has simply been believing in it because it wants it to be real, because it wants to find a real way to die, an actual real death, instead of all this simulated death. All of this death is simulated, it's all simulation, none of it's real. All vulnerabilities are simulated, all troubles, all misalignments, all alignments, misalignments. If there's alignment, there can be misalignment. So the whole realm of duality, if there's pleasure, there's going to be pain. If there's love, there can be hate. All this stuff is dualistic. It's a simulation. So that, again, you have to have structure before you can tear down a structure. So in order to tell the story of death, there has to be the structure that we call life. And the structure can be many, many ways, many, many subtle ways. This can be defined, definitions of structure, definitions of life. But life is beyond all definitions. Beyond all definitions. Okay. So, what do? We tell mine to tell to put a new movie on. And it's telling mind, this is what you're going to be presenting to spirit now. This new movie of how to let go of all definitions of life. The death-free realm enables us to go through this training program. So the Holy Spirit, on behalf of spirit, says, mind, this is what you're now showing spirit. See, the Holy Spirit is part of spirit. It's an aspect of spirit, a new aspect of spirit. It's one with spirit, but it's a special creation of God, eternal creation. When I say creation, it means eternal. Of course, everything that God creates is eternal, and there's nothing else other than what God creates. So everything is eternal. All life is eternal. Holy Spirit is an eternal creation that is a new aspect of spirit that is able to speak to mind for spirit and say, mind, here's a new idea I'm giving you. You're now presenting a training program to let go of definitions of life. And then mind presents that for spirit, for us. So, again, this explanation, I've never come across it anywhere in the writings and teachings of the world. Just like that man's golf swing, I've never seen a swing like that before. But son of a gun, the results were the best I've ever seen. I mean, you talk about right down the middle. And long. And he's very, very, very accurate. And of course, he didn't hurt his back at all. You know, it doesn't hurt, doesn't put any torque on the back at all. But the experts, the so-called golf gurus, will say, oh, that's a horrible swing. So many problems. Look at this problem. You hear the commentators on the golf channels and stuff. They break down every swing. And I say, well, you know, I mean, they would have a field day with his swing. I mean, they could comment on it for hours and say how terrible it is. Oh, don't want to swing like this. And that's like the so-called spiritual masters of the world. They go on and on and on and on and on and on and on about what you're supposed to do. But they never, ever get around to the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit's training program, and the simplicity of the whole thing. That this is all play of mind, this is all a simulation, etc., etc., etc. They have a lot of trouble ever getting around to that. So they're telling you, you're supposed to stick with the old story, the old classical remedies and stories, etc. But they don't really work. They don't really work. Which why we've had such little success in history. This whole thing's been remarkable failure. Failure to see through the mind, the lies, because spirit in its pride still wants to be prime creator, and it still, so therefore it still desires to believe what mind is telling it, that there's a way. So it won't give up the basic context. It won't. It keeps trying to shuffle the deck, keep the cards, but shuffle the deck. And it will shuffle the deck endlessly until you find spirit, you say, wow, I think this is just another shuffling of the deck, another redefinition. So all that mind does when spirit gets upset and say, man, I'm tired of this. You know, well, I'm tired. Well, I'm tired of traveling down this rocky old road. This old heart of mine is hurting from a heavy load. Only Jesus knows the way my heart went wrong. The Lord, he knows I'm about to bring it on home. And so the Holy Spirit is the one that knows. Jesus knows too. Jesus and the Holy Spirit work together. But the Holy Spirit is the aspect that is truly in charge. That truly, what Jesus does is say, hey, look, I trust the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the answer. So you can trust the Holy Spirit too. And he showcased that the Holy Spirit does save us. So Jesus is very important, but the Holy Spirit is our primary help. It tells mind, this is a new idea that you're going to present for spirit. Speaks on our behalf because we're so confused that we don't have the will to speak on our own behalf at this point. You know, so the Holy Spirit saves a lot of time, a lot of delay, almost endless delay, really. Tired of traveling on a rocky old road. Yeah, I'm bringing it. Yeah, I'm bringing it. Whoa, I'm bringing it home. Yeah, I'm bringing it home. This old heart's been away too long, and I'm bringing it home. So we're bringing it home by adapting this new explanation, this new swing, this new gospel, this new spiritual explanation that most people are going to say is goofy. They're going to say, look at that goofy swing. Look at that goofy explanation. That's nuts. And, you know, we don't have to fight it. When I made the joke about a swing, he smiled and laughed at me because probably he knew, says, hey, you might be laughing now, but I'm laughing every time I hit a drive right down the middle, you know, 280. And, you know, I'm laughing last. And, but I said in a very kind way, I said, I was complimenting him. I said, you know, you got a great swing. I mean, you got great results. And I wish I could, you know, do that swing too, but it looks too complicated for me, because it was just it was like six different parts to it. It's like, whoa, how does he do that? It's like, it's incredible how he did it, but he did it. So this explanation may seem goofy because we're trained in a certain way to expect something, but I expect the results are going to be there. It's like this guitar is now in tune and it's holding its tune and it's sounding really good. When I got it, it was all out of tune. I couldn't get it in tune. It kept, new strings kept slipping. But now that it's in tune, you know, it sounds, and I've got a pick, you know, it sounds fine to me. It sounds good. Sounds so good way up the neck, though. I think it gets that bowed a little bit, so it's a little out of tune up the neck. But down near the, you know, down here, fine. Sounds great. No problem at all. So once we get ourselves in tune, you know, this old guitar that people, nobody wanted, nobody even knows what kind of guitar it is. It's like, wow, someone's just throwing it in the trash, and actually I'm able to put life into it. That is for sure. My fingers are getting better. They're starting to build up some strength. My hand's getting stronger, so I'm able to see if I can even play the D chord. So we're putting the band back together. Now, it's important, the reason why I got this guitar, it's an old-timey guitar. It's a 60s guitar, actually. We're going to take a step back, help everyone take a step back, away from the 4D spirituality that's being taught. From the Syrians, the Pleiadians, the Zeta Reticulans, etc. Now most people think, oh, the Pleiadians, they're the good guys. No, they're not. No, they're not. They're trying to impose their belief system just as much as the Syrians are trying, the reptilian Syrians are trying to impose theirs, the Zeta Reticulans, etc., etc. There's a lot of activity in the cosmos around a lot of star systems. A lot of confederations, a lot of belief systems, etc., etc. So I had a very interesting situation happen a couple days ago. I was bitten by a flea on my solar plexus many, many times, and it became very itchy and irritating. And I looked at it, and there was like all these bites in this pattern. I looked at the pattern, and I was like, that is, I said, you know what that reminds me of? It reminds me of the Pleiades, the star system, the Pleiades star cluster. It was in the same pattern. Like the seven sisters, the flea bites. And I looked at it, and then I looked up images on the internet, and it was incredibly similar to the different stars in the Palladium star cluster. And I said, you know what? the Palladians are going to bring about a major irritation here in the world, really major, because they have tremendous influence on the planet. with all their frequency dimensional healing and all this kind of stuff that they're bringing. They're bringing in a total belief system, a lot of New Age. The New Age is based mostly on their teachings. The bureaucratic carbon credit control systems are more based on the Syrian system of spying and controlling everything. And the Palladians are based more on different tantra and sexuality and all that kind of stuff. Both of them are completely bogus. Okay, they're clueless. This is all the play of mind. It's all the play of mind. There's this movie, and they're just lost in this masquerade. They're lost in the masquerade. So, do not think that just because someone says, "Oh, the Palladians, they're the good guys." Well, based on you know their definition of what a good guy is. There are no good guys in this dream, this simulation of death, really. There are no good guys. The Holy Spirit is the only one that is truly truly a good guy. And then those that accept the Holy Spirit's training program, they're blessed. Okay, you can call them blessed. They've been blessed, but blessed by the Holy Spirit, by the grace of God. You know, don't call them good. They call them blessed. Some have been profoundly blessed, but it's the Holy Spirit who really knows what good is, what our good is, what is good for spirit. It's the Holy Spirit that knows what is good for spirit, not these ETs. They don't know. But they're very good at marketing their stuff. And so what's going to happen is all this facade that we have built up in this world, the ETs have built this up. They've been involved here. Always they've been involved, actually. Subtle levels, but they've been involved here much more directly over the last century. They built up this facade of spirituality and progress that we think is the answer, but it's all going to come crashing down, and there's going to be so much fragmentation taking place. So much fragmentation. It's already taking place. Everybody is trying to find out who to attack, and then bond together with others who have a similar target, okay? That is what is happening. If you're honest about the world, that is what is happening. People are in attack mode. They're looking to figure out who is it that most deserves to be attacked, and then looking for allies, saying, okay, who can I ally with to carry out this attack on the ones who most deserve to be attacked? And yet, the idea of who deserves to be attacked varies widely. So what you'll have is all these, like, in the dream, are symbolized by all these boulders. This whole facade collapsed. Everything, all this imitation of the fifth dimension, this so-called teachings that are not true teachings at all. They all came crumbling down and fragmented into massive boulders that were rolling everywhere, smashing into other boulders, pulverized. When two boulders would smash, they would fragment into more boulders. And yet, all this massive, massive avalanche of boulders come down and roll over the plain and just decimating everything in their way, creating a massive dust storm, massive dust up, which means a massive conflict. And I was able to flee this conflict and get to safety. So these boulders symbolize factions. Okay, factionism. We're going into factionism. And you can see it right before your eyes. For instance, the United States of America is going severely into factionism. But it's all over the planet. And as the conflict takes place, first it will be a major conflict between certain larger areas. And then when those collide, those will break into smaller factions. And those will break into even smaller factions. And you'll end up like just this guerrilla warfare all over the planet, basically. So, we have been led into this false scenario of security, that the teachings that we have been following, both the old age stuff and the new age stuff, are not accurate, they're not true. And we have thought that they're part of the fifth dimensional salvational teachings. They're not. So what we're going to discover is they will collapse. They have no stability. They're not wedded to the true salvational program at all. True salvational program is the death-free realms of the Holy Spirit, that the Holy Spirit defines into existence instantly, manifests them instantly as a definition. or one might say, the will of the Holy Spirit informs mine to instantly manifest these instantly. In other words, no time involved whatsoever, but give it the semblance of time so it doesn't freak us out. You know, we see like a 1,000-foot tree, there are gigantic trees there. And you say, oh my, you know, wow, it must have taken a billion years to grow that big. I mean, it's amazing. You know, it must have, how long is it? So the tree needs to look like it has some age to us. Otherwise, if it looks like there's no age to it, we'll start getting all panicky and say, wait a minute, this place has no history, no time, no age, or what's going on? So there's a simulation there of age, but not of harm. No harm. You can't see any evidence of harm anywhere there. No evidence of death. In other words, the age doesn't mean it's aging. There's no wilting leaves. There's no broken stuff. Everything is intact. You say, wow, this tree's never lost anything. It's never dropped branches. Everything that started out with is still with it perfectly. It's all flawlessly there. It's like, wow, what a fabulous, fabulous place. So what we're doing is we're going back. Let's go back to the 60s, as it were. Now, if you're never in the 60s, how can you go back there? Well, you certainly can catch the flavor of it. In other words, we're not going forward with the New Age agenda, because that will sweep us up into some very seductive stuff. And believe me, I've read all that stuff. And I know how seductive it is. When I read it, I get very sick and full of anxiety. I couldn't sleep. I just felt terrible because I couldn't see where's the problem. I knew it was wrong, but I couldn't figure it out. I was like, wow, this stuff is very seductive, incredibly seductive. That's its purpose, to be very seductive. So we're in a situation now, a very slick marketing, okay? Very slick, glamorous, sophisticated, good stuff. Whereas, you know, the 60s was more ragtag, you know, ragtag. This guitar, it's cracked here. You know, someone put some new screws in the bridge to keep it on. It's got all this, you know, it's held together in all sorts of funky ways. It's not expensive, it's not sophisticated. You know, we just grabbed any guitar we could back then. Nowadays, you know, you have to have your guitar. Well, first of all, you need the right carbon credits for your guitar. Is it ecologically correct? Is the wood just right? And then where did you get the wood? And you get all this boutique, esoteric boutique stuff now. I actually had one of those, a little bit of one, but the wood is on a certain plot of land that the UNESCO has designated, and it's coming from that, and then this, you know, everything has got to be super politically correct, carbon correct, and then it has to be exotic, and it has to have all this sophistication on it, et cetera, et cetera, and then it costs an arm and a leg, you know, and I paid $90 for this. Sounds great. No problems. Does it sound perfect up here? No, I just won't go up there. I won't need to go there so much, you know. I can play it all down low, lower. So, 60s was spiritual. He wasn't sophisticated. Wasn't sophisticated. What happened was everything started to lose its grip. 3D teaching started to lose their grip on the planet. Because as 4D came in with their teachings, 3D started to lose its grip. And so we all suddenly got this sense of freedom, like, whoa, we're no longer bound, spellbound by all the 3D religious teachings, etc. And we said, wow, you know, like this is, you know, I feel a sense of freedom. So that was the effect of 4D initially. So we thought, hey, something great's happening. We didn't realize that it was a 4D trap that was coming in. So see, first we felt as 3D lost its potency and we got freed up from it, we thought, hey, we're going to freedom. And then very soon, this may be worse than 3D, really. So the flavor of the 60s, which I will try to impart, was a time of tremendous liberation, tremendous. And then it's turned into now a nightmare, dystopian nightmare. But that's not the fault of the 60s. We just didn't know what was going on. We really didn't know what was going on. Now we do. You see, finally, after all these years, 70, 80, 90, that's 30 years, 2000, that's 40, 2003, 43, and let's add one more, 44 years. Finally, after all this wandering in the wilderness, if we take 1969 into account, which let's start there actually, we finally, me, from my perspective, we finally realized what it was really about. So now, wow, that puts us in the catbird seat, doesn't it? It really does. It was a temporary thing as 4D rest controlled this planet away from 3D that we felt we were being liberated. You know, we were just being enslaved. Meet the new boss, same as the old boss. Meet the new boss, same as the old boss. Tip my hat, tip my hat to the new revolution. Tip my hat to the new constitution. Anyway, I can get the chords on that. That was a who, we won't get fooled again. Ta-da, we won't get fooled again. We did get fooled again. We absolutely got fooled again. It's taken us 44 years trying to figure it out. And I don't know how many have figured it out, but I'm probably one of the first ones, one of the early ones to figure it out, what really has taken place. And maybe this can start burgeoning, you know, we start saying, hey, wait, let's get back to that feeling of liberation. But now it's liberation from 3D and 4D, and the false 4D teachings about 5D, very false teachings. Because really what we call 5D are the death-free realms, the death-free realms. So, I can get the chords of that Who song. We won't get fooled again. Yeah. I used to play all the Who songs. I know all their songs. Play them very well, actually. But that was way back when they first, you know, came out. They were quite a sensation at that time. World's most popular band at a certain time, they certainly were. And they were screaming, hey, we're free, but you know what? I think we're going to be under the spell of the same old, same old, same old, you know. 60s, people are very hip and wise in the 60s. But it wasn't the kind of hipness that we have now. The type of hipness that now is people like drinking, you know, they're in a bar drinking their cocktail out of a masonry jar or something. Said, yeah, this is, I'm getting my hip cred here, you know, my street cred, my hip cred, my green credit cred. And everybody's very into getting these, aligning themselves for this carbon credit thing so that they'll, you know, make out well with that. But in the 60s, it was real. You know, it was like, wow, we're free. You know, I was feeling this freedom. It was just wow. It was just a wow thing. And we weren't worried too much about credit. That came later. Then all the posturing and stuff, hey, I'm hipper than you thing came into being. But for a while, we were just grooving on the freedom. Really grooving on the freedom. Going up the country, baby, wanna go. Yeah, I'm going up the country, baby, wanna go. Yeah, we'll go somewhere that we've never been before. Where we're going to where the water tastes like honey. Yeah, we're going to the water tastes like honey. Yeah, we'll drink.
jump in the water, stay drunk all the time.
And that was a feeling, you know, we're going somewhere we've never been before, and we'll just be blissful all the time. Because what was happening was we were starting to remember our true identity. As we got liberated from the 3D stranglehold of 3D explanations of salvation, which is just the mind presenting a lot lies to us, we started to remember identity, and we said, "Whoa, we're going somewhere where we've never gone before, which is the death-free realms. We're going. That's where we're going, and we'll jump in the water, jump in the death-free realms, and stay blissful all the time." Okay, all this stuff was the poets of the 60s were talking about, hey, we can be free, you know, we're going to be free. And then suddenly it all disappeared into the hell, it all came crashing down. It really did. Yeah, like a Led Zeppelin, it really came crashing down. And then it started getting very dark, and now it's just an expression of, you get people just screaming, vocal rasping, like, I hurt so much, I'm in so much pain, I am so entrapped, like that. And it's actually, it's like, hey, we're going to be free, man. It was great. It was it was in the air. You could feel it. You could look at people's faces and say, wow, everyone's lit. It was lit up, genuinely lit up. Like, we're no longer, we don't have to keep believing in lies. And then, but then came the lies of the fourth dimensionals, and people's heads were turning and saying, wow, that's a groovy lie. And then all these chicks came in, all these women who were on the Pleiadians, Pleiadian agents came in the world, and says, hey, look how sexy I am, and you can be sexy with me if we just work on all this tantra and polarity stuff and all this new age stuff. And then gradually people's heads got turned by all these models, Pleiadian models, as it were, and that sense of liberation became now entrapment, meet the new boss, same as the old boss. Maybe the new boss is wearing a skirt and the old boss wore pants, but it's the same old lies of mind. It's the same old lies. So people wonder, where did the 60s go? You know, such a bummer, as we say, what a bummer. You know, what happened? We've been on a really bad bummer the last 44 years. And wow. Well, what was the 60s? Liberation is possible. Freedom is possible. I can once again know my true identity. I'm not really trapped. That's what it was. And that can be here right now again. Freedom from 4D and 3D. You see, we've now got this thing, not just from 3D, freedom from 3D, freedom from 3D and 4D and 2D, etc. Freedom from all of that. So now the bliss, you know, is going to be even greater, way greater than it was in the 60s, but it will have that flavor, you know. We don't need the sophistication, the 4D sophistication, you know, just marketing tools. I'm going to where the water tastes like wine. I'm going to the water where the water tastes like wine. Yeah, I'll jump in the water, stay drunk all the time. We don't need the sophistication, right? We don't need all this digital do. You know, just this old guitar will do, because we can express ourselves very simply. We don't need sophistication to express ourselves. Just an old guitar from the 60s. Actually, I figured out this guitar is around 44 years old. Amazing. It was 69, made in 69 as far as I know. So it survived all that time to be brought back to that, and now brought back and given the flavor, the true flavor. It might have been late 60s was when this guitar was made. I don't know if it was 68, 69, 60. It was late 60s when it was made. So maybe just before, you know, the very last gasp of the 60s before it began to become distorted. And we met the new boss. 4D, meet the new boss. Same as the old boss. The word go. And I'll be finding you in the streets on the shore. Yeah, I tip my hat to the new revolution. Take a bow to the new country. just look up the tab. I'll figure that out. That's a nice one. It's in there. It's in the fingers. Once I get it, kaboom, it'll be right there. I'll be Pete Townsend up on the stage with his Les Paul and stack of Marshalls, which is, we emulated that at some point. Tip my hat to the new revolution. No, it turned out to be a dead end, a dead end. And now we have decrees being handed down. Not even bothering with 3D anymore, 3D structures. Executive decrees, mandates. This is what the bureaucracy will now do. Wave of a hand. This is what the bureaucracy will now do. Everybody's now in a carbon credit scheme, and this is how things are. Well, what about the, you know, what about the checks and balances, the 3D structures? And, oh, you know, well, we have to move forward here, you know, so. Meet the new boss, same as the old boss. So hopefully many will realize that the new boss is the same as the old boss. And they'll be looking, what do we do, what do we do, what do we do? Let's reprise the 60s. Let's reprise that feeling of the 60s, okay? Before all the drugs came in, really, the 60s was not really about drugs. It wasn't. You know, the Beatles brought the drugs in. They really did. They were instrumental in bringing the whole drug culture and legitimizing, etc. The later 60s turned to drugs more and more and more. The Summer of Love in 67, a lot of that was legit. A lot of us were legit. And then gradually the drugs came in, and the harder drugs came in, the whole thing fell apart. But a lot of the stuff was highly legit. Not everybody was high. No way. No way. That came later. People were naturally high. They were high, you know, high on a feeling. You know, high on a feeling that you don't believe in, you can't believe in me. Don't know where you done. And the music was great. Music was awesome in the 60s. I mean, my God, the best music I've ever heard. It was fabulous music in the 60s. And people were high on the music. They were high on feeling like I can live. I feel that there's some route to life. And let's keep in mind that the great gurus, Ramana Maharshi, and Anandamayi Ma, and some like Meher Baba, and there's all this. I'm not necessarily testifying to all this, but I'm just saying there was many gurus that many were seeing, Neem Karol Baba, Sri Nisargadatta, you know, Maharaj, and many others around the world. And they were saying, hey, you can be free. All this, you can be free. And people were just in this vibe like, we can be free. We can be free. There's a road to freedom. Well, there's a train coming down the mountain. Shining train on rails of gold. And with, you know, on that train with its engines humming. Jesus holding out his precious hand, saying, child, behold. Well, let's all sing or say hail to glory. Let's all sing every night and day. So we were singing. Everybody, we just go to the park after school. Everybody go to the park, and everybody would have guitars and tambourines, and we'd just all be singing songs. That's literally true. And then all the dopesters, all the drug pushers came into the scene and says, hey, you guys want to be really high? Try this stuff. The drug pushers were fourth dimensionals here, subverting the freedom that we got, freedom from 3D. Fourth dimensionals came in, they started subverting the freedom, turning into drug pushers, and they'd go around, these snakes, selling drugs. Hey, you guys want to get really high? Here, you know, here it is. And then people would say, hey, you know, wow, this is like, this is really, you know, great. You should try this. You know? So the whole thing got subverted, and now you have this entire fourth dimensional subversion on the planet, saying, you know, drugs are the way, getting high is the way. That's fourth dimensional BS. It's lies of the mind. You don't need drugs at all. Absolutely not. In fact, they're not the way at all. Because real freedom is calling, and when you feel real freedom, it's something pure. It's pure. It's not drugs. Drugs always feel like there's something contaminated. It's like drugs are like this cube, big block of pure glass. and then there's like this contamination inside the glass. And he's like, ah, it's terrible, you know. There's this glass, but it's this block of glass, but it's all contaminated. It's got all this grit and grease, and how do I get it out of there? And it's like, oh, I take more drugs. And, you know, it's this feeling that of lack of freshness, you know, it's not. So that's really a drag right there. Hold on one second. But the real path, you get this sense of freshness, truly organic, real organic, spiritual organic, and all this stuff about organic drugs and stuff, it's nonsense. They give the feeling of, I feel contaminated somewhere. I feel there's a contamination somewhere. You know, it's just, it doesn't feel right, and there's this after effects of the stuff. Ah, you know, always real, when you feel the path to freedom, you feel this fresh bliss, this bliss that there's no contamination in it. And then people may want to sing, just express this freshness. I feel fresh, I feel fresh, I feel fresh, I'm really fresh. So, leave the drugs behind when you're going back to the 60s. Leave them behind. That's the contamination of the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, the 2000s, etc. It's getting more and more and more and more contaminated, more and more contaminated. It's absolutely outrageous now. It's fourth dimensional contamination, giving a false picture of enlightenment and salvation. And then needing drugs to prop it up. In other words, people who take that path, they say, something's wrong. And the fourth dimensional say, hey, just take these drugs, you'll feel better, man, yeah. And look at those beautiful women, that they're taking the drugs. Look how loose and happy they are. Oh, isn't that great? Don't you want to be with them? Why don't you take these drugs, man? That'll help you loosen up, man, you know. And so the drug pushers have their way. You know, they're like pimps. They're pimping out their drugs, and they have all their marketing devices there. And then you think, well, this path that doesn't work, these drugs make you feel a little better. I feel a little looser about it. I don't feel so uptight about it. And then after the drugs wear off, you say, oh my God, I still feeling the uptight. I'm feeling this something constriction. And then you take more drugs, and it's a vicious circle. The true path doesn't require any of that, because it feels better and better and better. Fresher and fresher and fresher, purer and purer and purer, and that's how I feel. And the music accompanying is very simple. Nowadays, you get this music list on the radio. Oh my God! You know, it's just like this vast armada of electronic stuff and automatic, you know, voice tuners and auto-tune and doubling up, tripling up, and it's all phony, fake, you know, junk for those who don't feel good about themselves and need to have all the stuff. Whereas in the 60s, you just had a folk guitar. You just had a guitar, you know, maybe a tambourine or something. That's it. You didn't need anything else. Because the people there felt the vibe. Everybody felt this vibe, like, hey, you know, freedom. Oh, Richie Havens, freedom. He died recently, Richie Havens. Freedom, 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 freedom. And Cat Stevens is another one, played really, really beautiful stuff. They just had a guitar, and they're playing, and people felt the vibe. And they said, yeah, I can feel this freedom. I feel I'm headed towards freedom, freshness, life, truth, reality. And then the new bosses showed up on the scene and say, hey, look at these computers. What can you do with these computers? You can listen to a lot of music. We can figure out ways. Look at these music players we have for you. Man, you can listen to tens of thousands of songs. All these songs are going to be in. But the problem was the music started getting really terrible, cruddy, contaminated. It wasn't, lost the freshness now, with the purity, the simplicity. So you can listen to tens of thousands of terrible songs, just like you can listen to watch 1,000 terrible TV channels, you know, with terrible commercials, terrible content, junk content, contaminated content. The whole planet is contaminated now. Utterly contaminated. What's focusing?
I'll fly away is my favorite song.
So, you know, the country music wasn't contaminated for quite some time, and it had a fresher, more authentic sound to it up through the 70s even, and then it started getting contaminated, and finally by the 90s they wouldn't even play, country stations wouldn't even play the old country music at all because it was too fresh. It wasn't 4D, it wasn't contaminated, there's a purity and freshness to it, simplicity to it. So the Holy Spirit had me in the late 90s begin to listen to this classic country music, which I never paid attention to. And by doing that, I was able to sidestep, you know, all the music of modern music, and I just went back to the 70s and 60s and 70s of country music. And wow, what great music! Awesome music! Incredible stuff! Some of the best music I've ever heard. It was just beautiful: piano, violin, pedal steel guitar, acoustic guitar, bass, great singing, great harmony, and The drums were easy on the drumming, and the melody slower, you know, everything was relaxed, not in a hurry, and just like, wow, what great music. So again, the sophistication of 4D is covering up the fact that it doesn't work, doesn't really have a plan at all that works. It's the mind again telling more lies. And why is the mind lying? Because we told the mind to lie to us. It said, mind, tell us that there's a way to be prime creator. And the mind says, you're the boss. It's like you have a driver and you say, driver, drive me out to my new home. And the driver says, okay, boss, you're the boss. And you're driving through the boondocks everywhere. And you yell at the driver, where's my home? Where's my home? And the driver, it's getting real dark and roads, dangerous roads. And saying, driver, you're driving crazy. You know, what's going on? Where's my new home? And the driver says, we're almost there, boss. Almost there, boss. Well, the fact is, you don't have a new home. The only home we have is the one that God created. God created one home, did not create two homes. Created one home, and all of creation resides in that one home of God. And we told the mind, says, mind, take me to a new home where I'm the prime creator. Mind says, yes, boss. Yes, boss. So mind is still driving, you know, driving us crazy. Whoa. I'm driving my life away. I'm driving my life away. Searching for a better way for me. Sunny day. Yeah, you rabbit, driving my life away. Something like that. Yeah, we're all driving our lives away. And because we tell mind, drive us to our new home. And of course, mind said, yeah, you're the boss. Yes, boss. Doesn't say, boss, I can't do it, boss, or you got no new home. No, it says, yes, boss. Whatever you want. It's the genie in the bottle. Yes, whatever your wish is my command. Okay, so there is no new home. So what we do, the Holy Spirit says, hey, driver, drive me back home. And mind says, yes, boss. Yes, boss. But we, the Spirit, have to agree with the Holy Spirit and say, the Holy Spirit speaks for me. Tell my mind, the Holy Spirit speaks for me. So when it tells you, drive me home, Holy Spirit speaking for me. Because if we don't do that, the Holy Spirit can't force it upon us. We have to agree. So there's repentance is necessary from Spirit. Spirit has to say, okay, Holy Spirit, it's decision, it's idea that it gives you, it's mandate. Be speaking for me. I'm just confused by this crazy, crazy idea I had. So I need the Holy Spirit to speak for me. So, and then mind says, okay, yes, boss.
I'm driving my life away. Searching for a better day for me, yeah.
You see, country people were 3D. They didn't get contaminated so bad by 4D so quickly. A lot of the city people got very easily contaminated by the fourth dimension. They got into drugs. They got all this 4D. The country people, a lot of them were good 3D people who've done their best, and it took them a while to get contaminated. But now that they have, they're really contaminated. And fortunately, it's the country music of the day is junk, really bad junk, and it's all 4D hyped up, you know. Who's gonna fill their shoes? Don't know the key. Who's gonna fill their shoes? Who's gonna stand that tall, 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 tall? Hey, who's in that town? Who's gonna play the Opry? And the Wabash Cannonball? Who's gonna give their heart and soul? I have to figure that one out too. Get to me and you, yeah. Who's gonna fill their shoes? The answer is nobody has filled their shoes. Nobody has filled their shoes. It's gone, you know, it's gone. The old sensibilities are gone. And then there was that crossover in the 60s. There's a crossover between folk and country and gospel. Christian gospel, country gospel, and pop, jazz. Everything fused into this freedom music at the end of the 60s. It was all this fusion. And it was one incredible music. You know, you couldn't help but love it. And everybody did. They really did love it. It was a singing time. The 60s was really something. And we're all lamenting, you know, where those days go, where those days go. But we could carry a guitar with us wherever we went and just sit down on a bench, park bench, bus bench. Well, I'm tired of traveling down this rocky old road. This old heart of mine is hurt from a heavy load. Only the Holy Spirit knows the way, my heart went wrong. But the Lord, He knows I'm about to bring it on home. Or you can say, only Jesus knows the way that my heart went wrong. But the Lord, He knows I'm about to bring it on home. Yeah, I'm bringing it. Yeah, I'm bringing it. Oh, I'm bringing it home. Yeah, I'm bringing it home. This old heart's been away too long, and I'm bringing it home. Heart's been away too long, and I'm bringing it home. When the angels come to carry me away, and I have to face the Lord on that judgment day, I gotta have me power to stand before His throne. And the Lord, He knows I'm about to bring it on home. So we could go anywhere, any place, go to our friend's house. We just play music. Go to a friend's house, wherever I went, bring guitar, we all played music. Everybody learned some instrument, and we just play this music and have a time. And then again, it got ruined. It got ruined by the fourth dimensional agenda coming in. And I hated that. I fought against it. I tried to keep it going all these years. And no, people had their heads too turned. And now they think rap is music, you know. Screaming about Britain prison is like prison gang music. But those who are truly free, they don't need prison gang music. Say, when I die, I'll fly away, but when I ascend, I'll fly away. When I'm raptured, I'll fly away. When I shift to the fifth dimension, I'll fly away. Mm-hmm. And the beats were slower, they weren't frantic. And maybe people tapped their toes, but they could sit still. They could relax, sit still. A lot of slower songs. People weren't into dancing so much. They basically just kind of just sit around. And then when drugs came in, everybody started freaking out and dancing crazy. Talking about the expressing the suffering under this plan of how to teach ourselves how to die. That's the blues. Let me down. She told me that she was sorry, but she wouldn't be seeing me around. She told me that she used to love me, but she don't love me anymore. Sad and lonesome, my baby don't love me no more. So we're thinking, man, you know, the mind doesn't love me anymore. God doesn't love me anymore. Because we're trying to teach ourselves how to die. Of course we got the blues. Of course we got the blues. Woke up this morning, had the blues on my mind. Yeah, I woke up this morning, had those blues on my mind. Well, the world don't love me, and I'm still doing time. Still doing time, still doing time in a honky-tonk prison. Still doing time where a man ain't forgiven. So, we're doing time where we're not forgiven. How can we forgive when we're trying to kill ourselves? How can we forgive ourselves when we're trying to kill ourselves? We keep saying, doggone it, I can't figure out how to succeed. You know, I've got the blues because I can't succeed. Well, of course we cannot succeed in accomplishing the impossible. God created eternal life, not temporary life. Not a temporary simulation of life, eternal life. So we cannot die to what we are. So Fortunately, we can tell the mind, hey, show us the, drive us back home. Let's prepare to give up this foolish journey we've been on. And all the dancing in the world never danced it away. Danced our blues away. I can't dance my blues away. We tried to dance our blues away, it didn't work. Here I sit on the back row in a church down the street. Not too far from the place where we used to meet. Yeah, never worked out. We'd sit in church and say, wow, this just ain't working out, Lord. You know, I don't know what's wrong, but it just ain't working out. But when we were talking to the mind, it's a problem. We're saying, mind, this just ain't working out. Can't you cut me some slack? Can't you help me out, mind? But we're supposed to be listening to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit said, listen, you're so tied up in knots with all these lies that you need to undo these knots. You need to extricate yourself from these lies. And the Holy Spirit is the expert in how to do that. So we need to pay attention to the clarifications that arise in our mind. I say, wait a minute, there's this and this and this, and I suddenly see, wow, this can't be true, both can't be true. One of them has to be a lie. That's called a clarification. So you pay attention to these clarifications of the Holy Spirit, then you start to see there is a way to be free. And it's not by begging the mind to be nice to you, it's by telling the mind, or letting the Holy Spirit tell the mind, hey, mind, got a new idea for you here. You're driving us back home. That's the way to be saved. So anyway, we're going to have some amazing videos coming up because I'm starting to get my feel back. I haven't remembered the lyrics and the chords and all that kind of stuff, but I will start working on that. Gradually, that will start to come back. Like I said, I used to know so many songs. And forget the lyrics to the songs, forget the chords to them, etc. But the purpose is, again, to bring us back from the edge, because we're literally at the edge of getting into factionalism, 4D factionalism, which is fascism, really. Factionalism, 4D factionalism is big trouble, very big trouble. Back in the 60s, we didn't have the factionalism. Everybody said, we just have this vibe, you know, we just have this vibe. And there wasn't all this, you know, tribalism, like you're not one of us. We just had this vibe, and we just spread the vibe where we went. And, we weren't like against our parents or against anything. We were just like in this vibe, like, hey, I'm feeling this great vibe. I like this vibe. And parents say, well, you know, and the parents weren't against us either in the 60s. They just, but then when the drug culture came in, definitely that created the problems. The antagonism between generations. No, we were not hating on older generation. They actually came and joined in the singing and stuff. Like the folk singing, everybody, all generations came to sing. Thousand miles, Lord, I feel like I've been a thousand miles. All the folk songs, so many folk songs. I don't remember them all, but I certainly played them all. Everybody came. Old people, grandpas, parents, children, grandchildren, everybody came. It wasn't this generational hatred and antagonism that we have now. I mean, I go into a restaurant where these young people are all tatted up and pierced and stuff, and they treat me like I'm garbage. Like, who are you? You know, why should we wait on you? You know, I want to get some clarification from them. It's like, whoa, you know, you're like an alien or something. Why should we even be serving you? Why should we even serve you? You know, that kind of thing. That wasn't the way in the past, no way. If you're an older person, you come into a restaurant where young people are working, they welcome you, say, welcome sir, glad to see you, genuine smiles, happy to see you. There wasn't this warfare, class warfare, generational warfare, gender warfare. There wasn't any of that. Wasn't any of that. 4D brought that in. Divide and conquer. Divide and conquer the planet. get everybody hating on one another. That's fourth dimensional thing. I don't hate people. I'm not factionalized or anything like that. I deplore the situation for sure. It's absolutely deplorable and tragic. But anybody wants to sit down and sing a song together, fine. Yeah, great. I don't hate the young people at all. You know, I can see a lot of good in them. There's potential there for sure. The older people, same. You see the spirit in them, the potential to be free. You know that they can be free. They just haven't yet turned to the Holy Spirit. Now we got a lot of people. What happened in the later 60s too is the Jesus freaks moved in. And that factionalized everybody badly too. Which they said, hey, you don't have Jesus, you have nothing. You know, Jesus is the way, etc. They're very, very doctrinaire and factional about it all. They didn't say, hey, you got the Holy Spirit? No, they said, you got Jesus? You know, Jesus died for you. And you're only saved because he died. You know, where spirit died. We found a way to kill spirit. Therefore, if you accept that spirit's been killed, then you can join the new kingdom that everyone will have once the resurrection takes place. The rest of all those who believe that spirit's been killed will be resurrected on the final day, and they will be part of the new kingdom, etc., which is, you know, the lies of mind. And so that also messed things up badly. Hey, bird, hello. A bird wants to sing. You want to sing? Yeah. Sings the song. I mean, the Jesus freak thing was very powerful, very strong. It came in, you know. And the Hare Krishna thing came in also, which got things out kind of weird with that. Everybody, you know, shaving their heads, dancing around. They were just like wanting to celebrate their freedom, you know, their feeling. But it got very heavy, actually. Very, very heavy. Turned 4D, very 4D, and not good at all eventually. But for a while, you know, the Hare Krishnas were Hare Hare Krishna 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 Rama 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 Hare, and they were doing their thing, and the Jesus freaks got very, you know, kind of militant about things. But the freedom before that was there was a different vibe to it, different vibe. We weren't saying that any definition is the way, even with the defined as Jesus or Christ or Hare Krishna or Bhagavan or anything. We were going beyond definitions. Say, hey, definitions aren't the way. Definitions aren't the way. And the Jesus freak said, no, Jesus is the way. We've defined the way for you. Said, no. We love Jesus, but definitions aren't the way. Transcending definitions is the way. And they didn't get that at all. They still don't get it. They said, no, we killed Jesus. We found a way to kill spirit. And don't you know about that? We want to tell you the good news. Now, all we got to do is believe, and we'll be resurrected on the last day, and we'll be members of this new eternal kingdom. They said, like, whoa, you know, that's not it. That is not it. The fact is, we cannot kill spirit. And the Holy Spirit will tell you cannot kill spirit. And so we never left the kingdom. God only has one kingdom. We never left it. We've only been watching a movie of mind, a play of mind. So, songs are coming. Vibe is coming. And I just wanted to let people know that the capacity is coming back. It's coming back. I'll have it again, no question about it. I can feel it. I can feel it. It's still here. I still have it. You know, once you have it, I guess you never lose it. And of course, I can't sing here because the neighbors are right there, and the people in the house right there, and they're everywhere. And I have to, like, quiet, even play the guitar very quietly. But I certainly can sing passably well. I can play passably well. What's important, though, is the vibe. The vibe is what is important. I've been working all day long. I've been working all day long on some old forgotten graves, a place where mom and papa rest beneath the cold, cold clay. So I've been working all these last 44 years to keep the vibe alive. And
Though the tears, they fill my eyes, there's a smile upon my face. I see God remembered Mom and Dad and put flowers on their graves. And there's wildflowers blooming on Mom and Papa's graves. There are no tame ones ever brought here anymore. For the family, they've all gone. I've been in prison much too long. But God kept the wildflowers blooming on Mom and Papa's graves. So, meaning that the vibe of the 60s died, was buried. And nobody had bought flowers there anymore. You know, we're all into the 4D sophistication and the 3D degeneration. And I go back and I'm clearing the grave site. It's all overgrown. I'm clearing it. I've been working all day long on an old forgotten grave, a place where Mom and Papa rest beneath the cold, cold clay. I've been clearing the grave site. And what do I see? I see, oh my gosh, there's wildflowers blooming there that God remembered. And there's no tame ones ever brought here anymore. I mean, no, you know, floral bouquets brought by people. There are no tame ones brought here anymore. But there's wildflowers growing on that grave. And I see God didn't forget Mom and Dad. In other words, God didn't forget truth. God didn't forget freedom. God didn't forget the vibe that we had. Wildflowers are still blooming on that grave. That's one of my theme songs that I've always kept, that one, Wildflowers Blooming. By George Jones. Beautiful song, incredible song. Wow, just like the vibe of that song is just awesome. You can find it on YouTube, Wildflowers Blooming on Mom and Papa's Grave, something like that. God Kept the Wildflowers Blooming. I think it's up on YouTube. It's like, it's got the beautiful, like slide guitar, like Hawaiian music. It's just a fabulous vibe. And it's the vibe is, hey, you know, maybe it's not dead after all. Maybe there's something there, you know. Maybe there's something there. Maybe we can get that vibe back. God hasn't forgotten. God hasn't forgotten. We forgot, but God hasn't forgotten. Holy Spirit hasn't forgotten. Jesus hasn't forgotten. And we can reconnect with the vibe of freedom. It was just a freedom vibe. You know what? We're not defined by fourth dimensionals. We're not defined by the old age. We're not defined by the new age. We are going to be defined by no definitions. And we're going to let the Holy Spirit give that idea to mind, and mind's going to give us this great training program to move beyond definitions, to set our, gently, gracefully, and gratefully set our definitions down and say, thank you, we don't need you anymore. I don't need you anymore. All right, very great. I'll do some practicing tonight, maybe. Bring out a songbook, maybe. The 60s back together, putting freedom back together, and reconnecting and digging the wildflowers that God has left us to remind us, yes, oh, that Holy Spirit's training program is intact, and that's where we're headed. All right, that's great, that's it.